Hi, my name's Chris Wheeldon and I'm a choreographer. I trained at the Royal Ballet School. I started there when I was 8 and I graduated from the Royal Ballet when I was 18 and went into the company. And then I joined the New York City Ballet 2 years later, kind of by accident. I think I should tell you the story of how I got to New York. Have I ever told you that story? I was in the Royal Ballet and they had submitted me for a competition in Canada, the Eric Bruhn Prize. And I was rehearsing with a girl from the company. We were going to do Sleeping Beauty pas de deux and Ashton's Dream pas de deux. And about 3 weeks before the competition, I sprained my ankle and sort of spent the next 6-7 weeks on my couch with my foot up, wrapped in ice. And on the TV comes this commercial for Hoover vacuum cleaners. And the deal that they were offering was if you bought a specific model of vacuum cleaner, you get a round trip ticket to New York. So I was like, okay, well, that sounds good. I didn't have a vacuum cleaner. My apartment was a complete wreck. So I'm like, it's a win-win situation. I spend like £80, I buy this vacuum cleaner, and I get a free round trip ticket to New York. So I hobble down to the store, I buy the vacuum cleaner, I vacuum my apartment, I send the coupon to Virgin Atlantic, it was Virgin, and they sent me the round trip ticket, and I flew to New York about 3 weeks later. My foot was kind of getting better, but I needed to take class just to stay in shape. So I wrote to the New York City Ballet and said, can I come and take class and watch some performances? And I guess because I was from the Royal, they figured it was fine. And so they let me in and it was all downhill from there. Or I should say it was all uphill from there. They were auditioning for the Balanchine Celebration. They were auditioning Another Boy. And I think they had thought that I was auditioning for the company. And the director came in, Peter Martins came in, watched the end of class, and suddenly it was my first day in New York. I hadn't seen anything. I hadn't been to the Empire State Building. I hadn't been to the statue, nothing. And he invited me down to his office and he said, well, so why do you want to leave the Royal? And I was like, okay, what do I say now? Should I pretend that because I want to move to the New York City Ballet? Or, but I just said to him, well, I don't really, I just came to take class. And he said, well, I'm very interested and we're looking for boys. So go away, watch the company for a couple of days and maybe come back, see me at the end of the week and tell me what you think. So I did exactly that. And I saw performances that were so much more, seemed so much more involved for the men than the shows that we were doing in London. You know, they were dancing, the Corps de Ballet was dancing, different ballets every night, Robin's ballets, Balanchine obviously, and Peter's ballets and other choreographers that had been invited in. So I decided, well, I don't have anything to lose. You know, I was kind of on a good career path at the Royal, but I'd been there since I was 8 years old. And why not like live the life of a movie and move to New York? So I did. And that's how I joined the New York City Ballet. I started choreographing when I was 8, when I first joined the Royal Ballet School. They set our teachers on Saturday mornings. We'd do a short ballet class, and then we'd have like music and movement. So sometimes they just put music on and say like, "Be a leaf in the wind," or "Be a frog," or whatever, and we'd just hop around like 8-year-olds. But we were set this one assignment to make like a little ballet, and so I was one of two boys at that point in the class. And I remember pulling the girls and the other boy together and was like, okay, so I'm going to make a ballet. What should I do? Maybe I'll do like a pre-Swan Lake ballet. So it'll be the swans hatching out of the eggs. So I made this little piece and we performed it at a high school. We used to go, they used to send us out to do like education things and, you know, in preschool. So we went to this high school and we performed this little ballet, and I was 8 years old, and everyone was like, wow, it's a little piece. And So that's kind of how I started. And then all the way through the school, there were competitions every year. And so I would make pieces for that. And I won a couple of times. And, you know, like anything, once somebody tells you that they think you're good at it, then, and you get that kind of encouragement really early on, then you pursue it. And so I just kept choreographing through until I moved to New York. And then when I arrived at the New York City Ballet, I kind of rather presumptuously just dumped like a big box full of tapes down on Peter Martin's desk and said, you know, I'm here to dance, but I also choreograph. So in your much spare time, like he has any, just, you know, work your way through my oeuvre. And so he must have looked at one of the tapes and offered me the chance to do a piece for the school, like a workshop piece in the studio. And then from there, I did a couple of those, and then he invited me to make a workshop piece for the graduation performance at Juilliard, and then the Diamond Project, and so on and so on. Well, I knew I loved choreography even when I was dancing, and people used to say to me, actually Peter used to say to me, Peter Martins, you're going to reach a point where you can't do both. You can't be a dancer and you can't be a choreographer. It's too much of a divided passion. You need to give yourself 100% to one or the other. And I never had any interest in dancing in my own pieces, so it's not like I could really choreograph on myself. So it reached a point where I couldn't be stubborn anymore, and I had to accept that. And he was right. You know, at first I was like, oh, you know, I'm in my 20s, I'm fine, I can dance and choreograph. But it just reached a point where I danced a lot and felt good about what I danced, and I was a soloist. I wasn't going to become a principal. I knew that. And so it just felt, for me, the transition felt right to go to stop dancing. And I miss it now, and it was early because I was only 28. But I don't regret having stopped, because then I could really focus on my career. But I think as a choreographer already by that stage, I'd kind of started to establish myself both in the US and overseas as well. So, you know, it was just a matter of being able to say yes to more work, because I wasn't being committed, you know, I didn't have commitments as a dancer with City Ballet anymore. I think probably my life would be completely different. I think eventually I probably would have found my way into choreography, but the opportunities are fewer in the UK. The Royal Ballet support new choreography, and more so now probably than they did when I was there. They have like choreographic labs and things in the studios, and they have now, since the new opera house opened there, they have a black box theater and they do quite a lot of performances down there. But I think probably I would have stayed much more focused on becoming sort of the prince and sort of had that kind of more traditional classical ballet aspiration, rather than being exposed to the kind of choreography that you're exposed to in the New York City Ballet, which is so much about music and creating ballets that reflect musicality. And there's a sort of freedom in it, in a sense. You know, there's that kind of feeling of just get on and make a ballet, like don't futz about it. It doesn't always have to be about something. It can just be, just take a piece of music and have a go. You know, that was a really good education for me, because it gave me the confidence to do that, in a sense. So I don't know how things would have changed, but I've been lucky because I've managed to keep my foot in the door in London. So I sort of have the best of both worlds in a way. I have a great relationship with the Royal Ballet. My company performs at Sadler's Wells, which is our second home. So it's very much become, the company is considered sort of to be transatlantic because of its two homes, and I kind of feel the same way. I feel like I work now almost as much in the UK as I do in America.